Imagine you're flying through our atmosphere in a spaceship the size of an atom. As you cruise through this tiny world, you pass by more than 400,000 nitrogen molecules, 100,000 oxygen molecules, and 219 carbon dioxide molecules before you find what you're looking for, a single molecule of methane. One of the most powerful yet misunderstood greenhouse gases on Earth. Despite only making up the tiniest sliver of the atmosphere, just 0.0002%, this powerful greenhouse gas has been solely responsible for 30% of the planet's warming to date. To understand the story behind this potent greenhouse gas, we're going to follow 100 methane molecules throughout their entire existence, from birth to death. Just like CO2, methane's been on the rise since the Industrial Revolution. But while CO2's rise has been almost entirely driven by a single source, the burning of fossil fuels like oil, gas, and coal, the story is a bit more complicated for methane. Each of these 100 molecules looks identical, but they come from dozens of completely different sources. Like the rest of the world, methane emissions in the US generally fall into three main categories. First, the natural world. Wetlands are full of plant life. But when those plants get submerged underwater, they're eaten by a type of methane-producing microorganism called archaea. Archaea, as the name implies, are some of the most ancient life forms on Earth. They've likely existed for roughly 3.5 billion years. Archaea evolved on a much harsher Earth, full of extreme temperatures and conditions, and very little oxygen in the atmosphere. Today, these ancient microorganisms still thrive all around the world in similarly inhospitable environments that are boiling hot, acidic, or devoid of oxygen. Archaea, living throughout the US's wetlands, produce nearly all of the country's naturally occurring methane. Only a few come from other places, like mud volcanoes and hot springs, which vent methane from deep underground. For most of Earth's history, naturally occurring methane was the only source of methane. But in the last few centuries, humans have found countless ways to add more of it to the atmosphere. Which brings us to the next source of our 100 methane molecules. Agriculture and waste. Chickens, pigs, and sheep all produce some methane. But no one produces methane quite like cows. These cows love to eat grass, but grass is actually really difficult to digest. So difficult, the cows have four stomachs filled with millions of grass-digesting microbes, including methane-producing archaea, which convert a lot of that grass into methane gas. This methane escapes through farts and burps. In fact, cows' stomachs produce so much methane that it actually dissolves into the animal's bloodstream and escapes through its breath. Cows are methane machines. So how do scientists measure this?
One method is a technique called, and I swear this isn't a fart joke, bottom-up estimation.
They start by sticking a cow in a sealed room and measuring how much methane builds up over the course of a few days. They do this for lots of different types of cows, multiply that by the number of cows in the country, and they get a number. And while this method is not as precise as actual samples taken from the atmosphere, it gives us detailed information that would otherwise be invisible, like how much methane comes from goats or bison. So, using bottom-up estimation, we know that 18 of our 100 methane molecules come from livestock burps, nearly all of them from cows. After farm animals have digested their food and burped all their burps, another 7 methane molecules comes from their poop. This is especially true in large concentrated farms, which have so many animals, the farmers rely on giant tanks or pits just to store all the poop. And of course, these dark, sealed off pits are the perfect feasting ground for methane-producing archaea. As more farms have turned to concentrated manure systems, these methane emissions have been on the rise in recent decades. The next step of our journey brings us from animal waste to human waste. Most of our trash is stored in big underground landfills, another perfect feasting ground for, you guessed it, archaea. In the last few decades, many large landfills have started capturing their methane emissions, decreasing the amount that escapes into the atmosphere by roughly a third. The methane that does escape accounts for 13 of our 100 molecules. The remaining 3 molecules come from sources like wastewater, biomass burning, and certain crops like rice. At last, we've reached our final category, fossil fuels, responsible for a quarter of our methane molecules. Fossil fuels come from ancient carbon, buried underground for millions of years. Oil and coal deposits are usually full of methane bubbles. And then there's natural gas, which is just a marketing term for methane. When people extract any of these fossil fuels from the ground, some of it escapes into the atmosphere, sometimes in little leaks and sometimes in big bursts. And as natural gas, aka methane, moves through our country's massive fossil fuel network, it leaks into the atmosphere at pretty much every step. Leaks aren't consistent from location to location, so this is one area where bottom-up estimates fall short. Instead, scientists rely on another technique called, top-down estimation. Scientists take real measurements from the atmosphere, and on powerful computers, they run weather simulations in reverse to trace the emissions back to their sources. Top-down estimates are based on actual real-world measurements, but aren't as detailed as bottom-up estimates. Neither of them is perfect, but together, they can help paint a picture of what our methane emissions actually look like. That's where these 100 methane molecules came from. And now, they're busy warming the planet. In these first days in the atmosphere, a ton of methane traps 80 times more heat than a ton of CO2. The reason why it's so powerful is kind of surprising. As different greenhouse gases build up in the atmosphere, each new molecule gets a little less efficient at trapping heat. For example, CO2 was once an even more powerful greenhouse gas, but now there's so much of it that each new molecule is a little weaker than the last. Methane, on the other hand, is pretty rare, so every new molecule packs a huge punch. The high atmosphere is an inhospitable place full of super reactive chemicals called radicals. In less than a decade, the radicals break down the vast majority of the methane and turn it into carbon dioxide, the other really bad greenhouse gas. This second life as CO2 really matters for our molecules that came from fossil fuels and makes these emitters especially bad. Here's why. Most of our 100 molecules were plants at some point in the recent past. And plants suck CO2 out of the atmosphere. This creates a natural cycle where CO2 grows a plant, is broken into methane, then is broken back into CO2, where the process can repeat itself. But that's not the case for fossil fuels. Fossil fuels come from ancient carbon stored in the ground. So when fossil fuel methane eventually breaks down, it's adding new CO2 to our atmosphere, causing the planet to heat up even faster. Because of this, methane from fossil fuels can warm the planet as much as 38% more than methane from other sources. Back to our 100 molecules, freshly transformed into carbon dioxide. It'll take roughly 1,000 years for all of these CO2 molecules to slowly be absorbed into oceans, fields, forests, and flowers. And that is the life death, and second life of methane. Hey, thanks for watching. If you'd like to learn more about the data we use to make this or explore methane emissions for other countries, check out the link in our description.